Well, hello everyone, and it is another Facebook Live because it's Thursday, and I'm really excited this week because we have a holiday come up. Victoria Day is on Monday, and we actually get an extra day off too on Friday if you're at school like I am. So I'm pretty excited about that because I'm off tomorrow, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, so I'm going to get a lot of quilting things done. So I keep telling myself anyway. Probably more quilting business than fun quilting for me, but, you know, it'll be quilting time, so that's all good. So let me just make sure that we are live here and everything's looking good, or you can shoot me a hello, and that will let me know that you're seeing me. Just takes me a minute to check on some things here. Hopefully I can see myself. There I am. So it looks like I'm good, and we're live. So today is a surprise topic. I didn't tell you what I was going to talk about today, and I'm not doing Q&A today, so I didn't ask for questions, and I didn't get too many, so that's good. I did get some, and I will get to those another time. Actually, one person was asking me, a couple people wanted to know how to use rulers when you're cutting your fabric, how to properly use them, and that is difficult to show on a Facebook Live video, so I'm going to be shooting a video on how to do that and explaining a few ideas and ways to do that. And what to look out for. So you can expect to see that on my YouTube channel. So if you are not a subscriber to my YouTube channel, you can certainly become one. I'd love to have you watch me there too. And you can find me at www.youtube.com/chatterboxquilter. So you can just go on there and you can view my videos and become a subscriber, and then you'll get notifications every time I post a new video, which is every week, at least every week, sometimes more often. Okay, so let me talk about a few things today. I was really excited because I got some new quilting books. So, hello Rob, how are you doing in the Netherlands? I'm sure you're enjoying beautiful weather there and beautiful flowers. My apple tree is out in bloom right now. It looks spectacular, and I'm hoping the blossoms stay on for a while. We don't get a wind or hail or something to knock them down. But anyway, okay, so I digress. What I'm excited about is I got some new books, and I love books. I have way too many quilting books. I have over 400 quilting books. I love books. I love to read too. So it's not just quilting books. Thank God we have a really good public library system in Calgary because I'm there every week getting more books out. So, but when it comes to quilting and there's good books, I like to buy them so I have them for reference and inspiration as well. And if you want to know how I store my books, well, I'll have to tell you that another time because I have different ways I do that. So anyway, let's see here. Oh, Rob says it's raining there. It was pouring here yesterday off and on too, and cold. So still getting frost in the mornings here, some mornings too. So, but you know, that's spring in Calgary. So I wanted to tell you about some of these books I got though. These are from Beth Ann Nemish, who is a long arm quilter, and her company, I have to look to make sure I get it right, is called White Arbor Quilting. So White Arbor, A-R-B-O-R, quilting.com. And she does all kinds of wonderful free motion quilting. So one of my guild members in my long arm guild was getting a shipment of books and asked if anyone wanted any. And of course, I said, sure, let's get them all. So I got all her books. So let me just show you what I got now. I'm going to try and do this so you don't get a shine on this too much. There you go. If you can feather, you can freehand. So that's one of them. So you're taking the theme from the fabric that you're using in your quilt to do some of the designs on your quilt. If I can show you a few of them. So what I like, this is a good example actually. Oops, wrong page. What she shows you is she'll show you the design, but she also shows you where to start and how to go about making that design so that you're not just looking at a picture and going, I don't know how she created that. So she's very good about telling you how to do that in all her books. Here's some little birds and stuff. So she has all different kinds of designs in this, and she explains very well about how to create them too. So that one's kind of cool. This is another interesting one. The devil is in the details. You probably heard that expression. So you see the piping that's along the edge, excuse me, this quilt with like little pearls. She shows you how to do that type of thing in here. And not just, she has color photos in here too, not just black and white. So you can see here where she's used those on the inside, not on the outside edge, but on the inside edge. And she will show you how to do that. And she has different names for them too. And here's some other little details, not just the pearls, but little flanges and little ruffles and things like that. So if you have a vintage sewing machine and it has a ruffler with it, you can use that in your quilting too. So there's some information for you there. This one's called The Fast and the Fancy. Okay, and that's all feathers. So again, she has lots of details about how to create those. And you can see here she's actually got different colors. So she's got red to show you where you're going to go next and what you're going to add to those. So she tells you about how to do things fast. So they're going to be a little simpler designs. And then when you're adding more details to them, that's what she calls fancy. So lots of good information in this book as well. And that's how she's doing the different designs in this book. Sorry, I'm not very straight on some of these. Hello, Angel. How are you doing today? Glad to have you join us too. We're going through some books here. And sampler quilt smackdown. Okay, that's kind of cool too. Angela, how are you doing? You're enjoying the beautiful weather today, aren't you? My daughter's out in her hammock as I speak and as I'm doing this video. I'm hoping the weather holds because there are some dark clouds. I'm hoping it holds and I can go out and maybe bump her out of the hammock later on this afternoon. So you can see different things she's doing, showing you how to plan them. She has some full color pictures as well on these. Lots of different designs with the feathers in there. I like how she's showing you, you know, different ways to use them, incorporate them in quilts that have different blocks in them too. And by the way, I'm not showing you this because you won't be able to see this. It might be shiny is what I mean, but each of these has they're spiral bound, which I really love because you can open them up and put them by your machine to use them. And they all have these, you can see that from the reflection, hard plastic cover on the front. So that protects the books a bit. It's kind of nice. Nemishing, this is what they call the designs that she developed here. This is a freehand feather flourish. This is one of her older books, I think. And so she's showing you how to make feathers and again, how to use them in her books. And like, I am not a real feather person. Hello, Charlene, nice to see you here too. What I mean is I don't use a lot of feathers. Not that I don't like feathers, but I always look at them as most of us do and think, oh, they're so hard. When you look through some of these, they don't have to be perfect and they're combining different elements in them. So, you know, I look at those and I think, yeah, you know, I think I can do that. And when I look at this, okay, so here's a great difference here between them. There's your heirloom feathers on the one side, okay? Those are those perfect feathers you see people doing and I look at them and go, oh God, I'd never be able to do that, right? Then you can see her nemishing where she's adding different flourishes or different sizes and things like that. Yes, they do look intricate, don't they? But you know, if you follow along with how she shows you doing them and adding these different little flourishes and ferns and things like that, it becomes very doable. And because it doesn't have to all be the same, it's not all the same elements and all the same sizes, if you make a mistake, it doesn't really look like a mistake, right? Like you can just say, oh yeah, that was part of the design. So I love that. And then this is her latest book. It's called Quilted Textures from A to Zen. And this is background quilting, and she has all different kinds of designs in here. And what I love about these is they're in alphabetical order by what she calls them, and she shows you her design inspiration for them. So there's all kinds of fun little names on, I'm trying to think of some of these, like fish scale, fiddlehead fern, fossilized coral. Okay, that's a really interesting one. That's one near the, down the bottom part of the page. But, you know, she's got some really different names in here that would never think octopus, right? Labyrinth, and then when you look at them, you go, yeah, that's what they look like, right? So that's a really good one, actually, and those are great for background fillers as well. So those are the books I got recently, so I've got lots to play with on those when I get to my long arm machine, or you can use them on your domestic machine too, of course. So Beth Ann Nemish, whitearborquilting.com. If you're interested in some of her books or, you know, reading her blog posts and that, she's got lots of great information. So I would recommend you check her out. Okay, so what am I going to be talking about today? Okay, I have a title up now, don't I? Sewing machines and more. So I wanted to talk a little bit about sewing machines. Okay, we talked about more. That's the books I talked about. And I have some other things to mention to you later on too. But what I want, I was thinking the other day we were out looking for a new vehicle. I have two kids in the family, one who's driving, has been for a few years, one who is hopefully going to get his license this summer. And in Alberta, you can get your driver's license, your learner's permit at 14, which seems like way too young to me. But anyway, you can get your learner's permit at 14 and then you can get your driver's license by the time you're 16 or so. And my kids didn't. Hello, Carla. Good to see you here. My kids didn't get their licenses right away. Both of them just weren't really crazy about getting their driver's licenses right away, probably because we have a good transportation system in town here. We have what we call a C train, it's like a subway but it's above ground, and we have great buses and everything. So you really don't need a vehicle all the time in Calgary. So I think that's the reason. I know a lot of kids don't get their licenses really early. So anyway, my daughter's driving. She's out of town during the year, or well, through the school year, I should say, because she goes to school elsewhere because she's in university. And my son's going to be heading off. He's still going to be in Calgary next year, but he's probably going to want to use a car. So we need another car. Ah, you were 22 and you got your license. Oh my gosh, I got mine as soon as I could. But anyway, I lived in a small town. I didn't have any other way around, right? So, but anyway, so my kids are, you know, going to need cars, basically. So we think we're going to need another vehicle in the family. And we don't do driving holidays. We don't put a lot of vehicle miles on our vehicles. So, you know, we keep our cars for a long time. We look after them. We keep them for a long time. So by the time we go out to get a car, lots of things have changed on it. I mean, we have the van we have, which is a Honda Odyssey. Love Hondas. We've had it for, let me think now, 14 years. You would never know it to look at it. And it doesn't have a lot of kilometers on it. I should say kilometers because we're in kilometers in Canada here. So, you know, it's a great vehicle. We'll let our daughter drive that. She drives it in the summer when she's home mostly, and we'll let her take it up to Edmonton. But that's going to leave us a vehicle short. And we do camp. We have a tent trailer. So we need a vehicle that can haul the tent trailer, haul our stuff when we go camping, you know, haul things around a bit. So we need a little SUV, sport utility vehicle. So we went out the other day to look at one, so we'll make a decision soon, I'm sure. But the point is, things change on vehicles. And so now, like when we actually bought a new car about 3 years ago, a new car, because we don't always buy them new. And the differences between the van and it were major, right? The technology has improved so much now. You know, it's got GPS on it, voice recognition on it, it had heated seats. Doesn't have a heated steering wheel. That'd be nice in the winter, but, you know, just the technology part of it and the safety features, of course, that they have now, extra airbags that they have, you know, we don't have all the anti-collision or anti-lane shifting stuff, whatever all that is. We don't have that on this vehicle, but you can get all that type of thing too. So there's so many changes, right? That it becomes overwhelming. I mean, you go to look at the vehicle and you're going, oh, wow, it looks really nice and everything. You sit down inside and turn it on. You go, whoa, all this stuff, right? There's a computer screen in this thing and it's touch control and, you know, all this stuff, right? So it's really easy to get overwhelmed by things, right? And you kind of forget, what do I need in a vehicle? Okay, so when you're looking at sewing machines, it's kind of the same thing, right? Sewing machines improve all the time. New models come out every year and there's some new feature on it. All these bells and whistles, more decorative stitches, you know, wider throat space, whatever. There's all kinds of things that come out on them. So again, if you are looking for a new sewing machine or new to you sewing machine, it's easy to get overwhelmed. And of course, the salespeople really like you to look at those higher end machines, right? So you need to be a little careful, as when you go to purchase anything. I'm a real, you know, buyer beware type. Know your stuff before you go in. Make sure you know what you'll want before you go in. Because once you get in there and see all these other things, like, I mean, the worst situation is to look at the top model of whatever it is you're looking for, right? Because you look at that, you see all these features, you go, oh yeah, oh, gotta have it. And anything else doesn't look so good afterwards, right? So I would recommend you don't do that. Start at the bottom level and work up. That's much better. But when it comes to looking for a sewing machine, you know, again, you need to figure out what you're going to do with that machine, okay? Just like my car or sport utility vehicle I'm going to get has to be able to haul our tent trailer, so it has to have towing capacity of X number of weight. The same thing is for a sewing machine when I'm looking at. So when I'm looking at a car, it's got a tow, and for me, there'll be different features I want in a car than what you will want. So for me, and Charlie apparently has different ones than I do too. You'll hear him crying here. I have to have, and this sounds so ridiculous, lighted makeup mirrors, okay, on the passenger side and the driver's side. Because when I go out somewhere, I put my makeup on. I don't usually put my lipstick on till I'm at the place I'm going or it wears off. So I will, every morning when I go to work, when I drive the car I have, I put on my lipstick when I'm in the parking lot before I go in. So that, you know, visor comes down, the makeup mirror is lit up, and I put my lipstick on, and then I'm good to go. So that was a real sticking point for me when we looked at a vehicle. Does it have a lighted, it'll have a lighted driver's side makeup mirror usually, not always the passenger. I want that too for when I'm not driving, and same thing goes. I want to put my lipstick on. So that seems kind of superficial and ridiculous, but it is a feature I use every single day in the car. So it was important to me. It may not be important to you. It probably isn't important to my husband, but it was to me. So there are different things that are important to different people. And that is true with sewing machines too. So you have to think, how am I going to use the machine? Now, I am a quilter, so and a lot of you are, I know. So what you're going to look for in a machine is a really good straight stitch. That's my first thing, right? Whether I'm doing free motion quilting, whether I'm just piecing, it's got to have a really good quality straight stitch. It has to have the ability to run all kinds of threads in it as well. Those are, like, that's just the first thing I'm looking for, right? There's lots of other things. I like a knee lifter. I do applique. I like to be able to use that knee lifter so I can move the applique along as I'm finishing off the edges. That's an important thing to me. Needle up and down is also important because, again, when I'm doing applique, I want that needle to stay in the fabric, or if you're doing free motion quilting, you want that needle to stay down when you stop stitching. So those are just, you know, just off the top of my head, some quick responses to what do I need in a sewing machine, okay? So if you are a quilter and you need those things, then there's other nice things to have, right? Like a speed control is really nice to have when you're doing free motion quilting. good lighting. I expect good lighting on a machine too, right? But you know, they are different, so you need to check that out. You can supplement the lighting. Like if it had everything else you needed and the lighting you wish was a little bit better, you can also get add-ons to that. But, you know, there's what you'd really, really, really need to have. There's what you'd like to have. And what you will settle for is probably somewhere in between, okay? Because you get, you know, you'll get extra stuff on a machine that you may not want. But, you know, when you get to a certain level, you want this, and other stuff comes with it, right? Like your decorative stitches, for example. As a quilter, sometimes I use the decorative stitches, but I guarantee you I will never use all the decorative stitches on my newer, like I have a Janome 8900. I'll never use all the decorative stitches on it, but I do use some of them. So you get some extra bonuses in there. So that's what I wanted to tell you about sewing machines to start with. Make your must-have list. Do not walk into a sewing machine store or a quilt store or wherever they're selling machines in your area without a list of things you must have. I always start my shopping with that. This is what I have to have. Yeah, that's nice. But I really need these, okay? So if it doesn't have this, I'm not looking at that machine because it's not going to work for me. And I don't know about you, but like cars in our family, when I buy a machine, I'm going to keep it for a few years. I am not going to flip it, trade up the next year when the new model comes out. They're just too expensive to do that. They're thousands of dollars, depending, again, where you are. Here, they're thousands of dollars for these top-line quilting machines. So I don't want to be spending that every year. I expect a machine to be built well and to last me a long time, and I will pay good money for that. But I don't need a machine that's, you know, has all these bells and whistles on it and, you know, going to trade up in a couple years. It's not going to happen. Okay, I'm not going to do that. So I go in the store, I have my must-have list, okay? Now, if you are not a quilter, let's say you sew clothes, you're going to have a different must-have list than I will. So if you sew clothes, you will be looking at always a good straight stitch and a good stitching quality of the machine, but you will also want to make really good buttonholes, let's say. You'll probably want to be a free arm because, you know, if you're putting sleeves on stuff, you want to be able to get them on the machine to stitch easily. So you will have different requirements depending on the kind of sewing you do. So again, got to have that list, right? And you need to stick to your list, okay? Now, like I said, if there's some other things that come on that machine, that's a bonus. But if you get home and you've bought a machine that you were overwhelmed with because it was the newest thing and all these bells and whistles, and you find it doesn't have the feet you need to do proper hemming on a pair of pants or skirt or whatever, like say if you're a sewer, or, you know, I can't think off the top of my head exactly, but if it doesn't have some of those essential parts you want it to have, you're going to be disappointed, okay? And you're always going to say, why didn't I get the one that had blah, 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 okay? So you need to think this through, and you need to stick to your guns, okay? So don't ever walk in without a list. That's the first thing. And nowadays, I always say nowadays, makes me sound so old, right? But anyway, you know, you can find so much information on the internet. You can find information about the machine. You can look at the manual for the machines. You'll see exactly what it can do. You can go into groups and ask people, you know, does anyone have this machine? What do you think about it? Does it do this and this and this? So you can gather a lot of information before you go and actually look at the physical machine. And I think that's a good idea too. So you can narrow down the models you want to look at. So when you walk in the store, it saves you time, saves the salespeople time, and you can say, I want to look at this machine, this machine, this machine. And they go, oh, but we have this one. Oh, you go, no. I looked at those. I'm not interested in those. I want these other machines to look at and compare. And, you know, you can do that. So there's no point in looking at 15 or 20 machines. You will just be so confused at the end, you won't know, you won't remember what machine had what. Okay, so if you can narrow that down before you go to the store, and then just look at the machines you're really interested in. And I do the same thing, like we're doing the same thing with the cars, right? I'm only going to look at vehicles that I think I'm really interested in, because I don't want to waste my time or waste the salesperson's time either. So that's a good strategy as well. Get your information up front. Okay, so let's see what else. I have a few notes on this, so I just want to make sure I don't miss anything. So the one thing I want to mention too is, and you'll see behind me a couple machines here. I can't, my Janome's right to the side here. I can't really show you that. That's my newest machine, the one I use all the time for applique and usual stitching things I need. It's great. I love it. I haven't been disappointed in buying that Janome 8900 at all. It's been a great machine. I really like it. But you also know I'm a collector of vintage sewing machines. So when I'm talking about getting another sewing machine, it doesn't have to be a brand new sewing machine. Sorry, I'm trying to read comments here. Ah, yes. Angel says, yes, you got a machine. Overpay for things you never use. See, that's the thing, right? You got to be careful, right? That slippery slope, you know, they want you to buy something a little more expensive, got a little more things on it, stuff like that. So be careful. Yeah. But talking about the vintage sewing machine, so I've got a Bernina behind me. I got to move myself over here a bit so you can see. Okay, so this is the machine I had before, and you see I still have it. That's another thing. If you've got a good machine and you just want something that's got a few more newer features, like, for example, speed control, I really wanted that on my newest machine. My Janome or my Bernina didn't have it. So, you know, this is still a great machine, and I still do use it sometimes. It's more portable than my Janome. It's a little bit smaller, so it's easier for me to take to retreats and things like that. Or even easier to take and better size is my little Singer 221, one of the 221s I have. So you don't have to buy a brand new sewing machine. You can buy used modern sewing machines, so like the Bernina, and these still sell for a good amount of money as well. But you don't have to buy a brand new to you machine. Okay, so there are lots of good machines out there where some of these people buy a machine, and when the new model comes out, they trade it in and get the newer one. They haven't got many miles on their sewing machine, and you can get yourself a good deal if you buy it like that. Or if you buy it like I buy things online through Kijiji, or you might have Craigslist in the States, I guess, you can get good deals there because people just want to get rid of them. Maybe they buy them, you see it all the time too. Bought this machine, still in the box, never used. So, you know, you can get a good deal on some of those machines. And an even better deal if you're talking about vintage sewing machines, okay? So if you are looking for, as a quilter, a machine that has a really good straight stitch on it, these older Singers that I get have incredibly good stitches on them. They are sturdy. I talked about having machines that can last you a long time. You know, these machines are 60, 70 years old. Let me think. This one here is like, well, I shouldn't say it's that old. It's probably older than me. It's probably in the 60s or something like that, 60 years old or so. And it looks fantastic, and it sews really well, and it's going to last a long time, and I can maintain it, and I don't have to take it into a sewing machine person to get it up to speed or anything, unless something's really majorly wrong with it. But I can do a lot of the work myself. I can oil it myself. It keeps it running really well. It's great, right? And they're not that expensive. These are the more expensive of the vintage sewing machines, but still. If you have like $100, if you're in the States, you're even luckier. You can get them cheaper than that, I know. But you can, not this brand, sorry. You can get a vintage sewing machine cheaper. So you can get machines for $50, $30. I see people picking up for $10 and stuff at flea markets. And then they work really, really well. And they'll last forever. They're like tanks. They're all metal inside too, right? So they go and go and go and go. So, you know, when I'm straight stitching, I have a treadle machine upstairs, a Singer 66 Red Eye. And I really like working on it because it does a great straight stitch. It's quiet. It's relaxing. You know, your feet are going back and forth with the treadle. It's really nice. So, they're great for that. And that's what I like to use some of my vintage sewing machines for. Some of them have a wider throat space than the machines I have, the modern machines I have. Great for free motion quilting, right? So don't discount vintage sewing machines if you're looking for a sewing machine to stitch on. And especially if you're just starting into sewing or quilting, right? You don't want to spend a lot of money on a sewing machine, but you want something reliable that's going to work well for you. consider a vintage sewing machine, right? If you spent $50 on it, you decide you love quilting, you want to upgrade to a new modern machine, you know, you'll still have it for you to take to retreats, right? You have a smaller one. So that's something to consider. All right. And let's see here. What else was I going to tell you about that? Oh, I know. The other thing is, and I have people mention this to me, is some people say, like for me, what I always say is the best sewing machine for you is one that suits your needs and fits your budget. Okay? Because again, if you go out and you spend $2,000, $3,000 on a sewing machine when you really don't have that money and it's tough to get that money, I think that's a mistake. I don't think you should be buying something outside your budget because you can find other machines that fall within that budget, especially if you're not time constrained on when you need to have that machine. So take your time, look around, wait for deals. They always have sales on modern sewing machines, right? So you know, like around Christmas time and stuff, you're going to see good sales, different sometimes holiday times, you'll see good sales. So keep your eye out, right? Get a good deal. The other thing is people have also said if you are getting a machine, get a machine you can grow into. Okay, so maybe you know, a lot of machines nowadays, you can get them and they have the embroidery modules on them. Okay, so maybe you're kind of just starting into machine embroidery, but you're not doing a lot of it yet. So they might try and say to you, hey, buy this machine. It's got the embroidery module. When you get into embroidery full time, you know, you love doing it all the time. You've already got the machine for it. Well, the only thing I've got to say on that one is I don't agree with that. Okay, and I'll tell you why. First off, as you know, new sewing machines are coming out every year, okay? There's always new models out there. There's always new improvements. Sometimes there's new technology. Well, there is new technology that comes out with them. So if you're not doing that machine embroidery in this case at the time, and you're not sure how much you're going to get into it, really, because you're not doing a lot right now, you know, by the time you get into it, it could be another 2 or 3 years. Like, I don't know, right? It could be. And so by that time, they're going to have other sewing machines or other embroidery machines that could have a whole different, much better technology in them. So I think that you should get something that works and makes what you're doing now easy. It has all your must-haves that you wrote down your list on it, maybe a few extra bonuses, and it fits within your budget. I think that's a big one. I think that's a really big one. Because, you know, you want to have money left over to spend on fabrics and books and thread and all those fun things too, right? So you'd hate to, you know, it's like buying a house with a mortgage that's so huge that you can no longer afford to furnish it and you can't afford to go on vacations and things like that. I mean, I'm a big believer in you don't do something if you can't afford to do it. So if you're going to buy a machine and spend lots of money on it, and that means that you no longer can, you know, go to a quilt show and buy some books or some fabric, or you can't treat yourself to things, I that's not where I would go. That's not my thing. So you may think differently, but that's just me. So I'm still trying to read comments here. My comments come across, I don't know what they look like to you guys, but to me they come across and they're white. So they're hard to see because they're showing up on my white cabinets behind me. Ah, yes. See, embroidery machine software, I never use it, said Angel. Yes, and when I bought this Bernina, when I first started quilting, I started on a Singer, not a vintage Singer, but one from the 1980s. I still have it, but the cabinet, the case of it now, it's been in storage because I haven't used it for quite a few years. It is now yellow, so the plastic has yellowed, right, in it. But when I went to look for the machine, this one is what I ended up getting. When I went to look for this quite a few years ago when I first got into quilting, and realized I was going to actually do it, and I needed a better machine than the Singer for it. The machine that they tried to show me at first had an embroidery module on it. And I am just getting into machine embroidery a little bit, but that was like, I don't know, 10 or 12 years ago. I would not have used the embroidery module for 10 or 12 years. Okay, so I always said there's so much I still need to learn in quilting and so much I want to do in quilting that I don't really need that. And now I have an embroidery machine. I have a Janome 500 that I got, and it's a standalone embroidery machine. So I can, you know, do the embroidery on it, and I can have my other machine is still freed up to do quilting things on it. So that's a topic for another day, the difference between whether you should get them all in one or not or what, but we can talk about that another time. But what I wanted to mention to you when I'm talking about the machines, and I'm talking about the vintage sewing machines, is that I don't know if some of you are receiving, if you're a vintage sewing machine collector or you want to know more about them, I've been having freebies that have been going out to people. So information on various things to do with vintage sewing machines, like how, you know, what kind of pricing is on different ones and how to negotiate a good price on them. You know, how to research them before you go and buy them so you know what machine you're looking at, or what it can and can't do, and what questions you should ask, those types of things, where to find vintage sewing machines. So I have different downloads. So if you're not getting those and you want to get those, I will put comments in the group probably tomorrow. Like I usually put a recap of what I'm doing. So I'll put comments in there, and I'll put the areas where you need to go to get those, so you can get on my list and get some of those, because there's lots of great information in there. I've compiled a bunch of information. So if you're interested in that, I'd love to have you download those. If you're not in my group, I think the ones I'm watching right now or that are watching right now are in my group. But again, if you're not in my Facebook group and you would like to join me there, I'd love to have you there. We have a great group of people there, and we talk about different things. So you could do that by going to my website, www.chatterboxquilts.com/FB group. So FBGROUP, and I'll get your request and can add you to the group. And if you have any questions or comments, I'd love to hear what you think about buying sewing machines or buying cars. Either one. Just leave them in the comments, and so I can get back to you on some of those. So that's basically what I have for today, I think. I think I've covered everything. I want to make sure I always write things down that I want to make sure I talk to you about. And I think I've covered most of those today. But again, you know, the big points here for the sewing machine are write down what you absolutely have to have and realize that what you want to have in a machine may not be the same as what one of your friends wants to have in a machine. And that's okay, right? There's lots of different machines out there. That's okay. So don't be swayed by other people who go, oh man, I love this. I use it all the time. And you go, I don't think I would. That's okay. That's not on your must-have list. So your must-have list and then your kind of like-to-have list. Okay, so you know, if it fits on that machine, maybe it comes with that machine. Yay, that'd be great with the one that has all your must-haves. So those are things to do. Do your research online before you go. Narrow it down to maybe three different models that you're looking at. They could all be in the same, like they could all be Giannone's, or they could all be Bernini's, or you might be looking between lines as well. And then go into the shop. You know, when they ask you what you're looking for, you tell them it has to have boom, 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 right? And you can also tell them, I think sometimes this is just as helpful, what I don't want. Okay, so if I don't want a machine that has an embroidery module on it, that was me. Okay, so don't even go there. You know, they kept trying to push me in that area. I'm going, no, I'm not doing that. I don't see me doing that in the foreseeable future. Okay, and keep in mind, you know, figure out your budget ahead of time too. Okay, that's a good thing to do too. How much can you really afford to spend on a machine? And maybe there's some financing plans that can be helpful, but stick to that too. So it's a big purchase, right? Like a car, a house, or even sewing machine. I mean, some sewing machines can be $10,000, $13,000. And then of course you get into long arms. That's a whole other price range category. But you know, you have to know what you can afford and get the machine you want. And if you're not sure about it, you know, like again, it's hard to make a decision when you're there the first look at it, let's say. Maybe you've looked at online, you have an idea about it and stuff. But you want to go there, take some, they usually have fabric for you, but take some fabric, like the kind of fabric you'll be sewing with. That's the other thing, okay? So if you're sewing leather, let's just say you're sewing leather, take some leather with you. See if that machine's going to stitch through leather. If you sew cotton or quilter, take some cotton with you. Take a quilt batting and try some free motion with it, you know, and go back, right? If you kind of like the machine, but you're not sure, you get home, you go, oh, I forgot to check to see if it did this, go back again, right? It's a big budget purchase. You want to take your time and you know, make sure you get the right machine for you. Okay, so again, if you have any questions or comments on what I've been talking about today, please put them in the comments below and I will get back to you. I will be back here next Thursday at 1 o'clock Mountain Standard Time again to talk to you. And I thank you for joining me today, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Bye now.